Oh, I love grace and I love mercy, don't you? Oh, David says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Goodness and mercy. Grace. Amen. Today is God's grace. God's grace. And if you have your Bibles, I'm going to be in James chapter 4. And when we think about grace, the God's grace, and when we look at that and the meaning of that is simply the freely giving unmerited favor and the love of God. We don't deserve grace. We don't deserve mercy. But God, amen, loves us enough that he bestows those gifts to us. He loved us. He loved us when we was unlovable. And many times we become unlovable, don't we? If you don't believe me, just ask your neighbor. Right? We all become unlovable at times. But the Bible tells me over in Romans chapter 5 and verses 8 and 10, but God commanded his love toward us. Commanded his love toward us. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And in essence, when we was unlovable, Christ loved us enough to go to the old rugged cross and pay a debt we could not pay. He loved us that much. He says, much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. He bestowed mercy and grace on us. Somebody said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know, in this world, we won't find much grace. We won't find much grace. We won't find very much unmerited love. We won't find that in this world. What do you mean? This world is full of evil. It's a dog-eat-dog world. Why is that? Why is that? Because the natural spirit of man is full of lust and envy. And that sinful nature takes him deeper and deeper into the depths of sinful activity if allowed to go unchecked. And if you think about this, think about all the evil that is in this world today. We cannot turn on the news without hearing about violence on every corner. We can't turn on the news where we don't see where somebody has killed somebody else. There is no respect for God or mankind in this dog-eat world we're living in. We're living in some perilous times, by the way. Why? Because we don't want to accept God's grace and mercy into our lives. We don't want to accept that precious gift that we're talking about today, God's grace. And whenever we leave God out, you get what you get. You get what you get. James tells us, in other words, over here in chapter 4 and verse 6, that God gives grace, amen, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore, he said, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Why was James saying this? Because he was speaking to his people, and his people had forsaken God. And matter of fact, you know, they were scattered through the Mediterranean at this time that James is speaking here. And he says, man, you got to get back to the basics. You got to get back to loving God. You got to get back to loving God. You allow the world to creep into you. And I believe, without a shadow of doubt, today, as a church and as a body of Christ, we have allowed the world to sneak in. And when the world sneaks in, it steals your joy. It steals your want to. And it instills fear in every heart. Fear in every heart. The Bible tells me that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of a sound mind. Now, friend, if you want to conquer those things, you got to, amen, turn to grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved an old wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Thank God for grace that came looking for me. Oh, my goodness, amen. That ought to make a Presbyterian shout this morning. Amen. Glory to God, amen. Amen. But James says here, hey, if you get rid of your pride, get rid of all that envy and strife in your heart, God wants to fill you with grace. God wants to fill you with grace. He says in verse 4 there, he adulterers and adulteress, know ye not that the friendship of this world is enemy with God? And as long as you have the world in you, you're not going to get the peace of God, and you're not going to feel that presence of grace in your life. And whosoever is a friend of this world is enemy with God, a hostile to God. But he says this in the latter part, and I like this. But whosoever therefore will be a friend of this world is the enemy of God. But my goodness, when you think about, amen, if you humble yourself, you'll receive grace of God. Listen, let's read that verse again. But he giveth more grace. Wherefore he said, God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. And I like that, amen. That's the verse I like, and I like that latter part. God's grace. So we have to shed ourselves of the world to feel God's grace in our lives. Why is that important? Because the world is evil. The world only has pride and envy. The world is not a friendly place to be. And our friendship with this world is a product of our own pride and envy, because we want what the world has to offer more than what Jesus has to offer us. We need God's grace, don't you think? We need God's grace. Why do we need God's grace? To overcome our sinful nature and keep us in check. James says that God is good at giving grace to those who humble themselves before him. God is good at that. Why? Because he wants to save us. And I like that, amen. The first thing I want you to see, God's grace saves us. He wants to save us. He's not willing that any should perish, but all come to repentance. Aren't you glad that God wants to save you? And not only you, but others as well. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And the Bible says we are saved by grace through faith. Look at Ephesians 2:8. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself, but it is the gift of God. But we're living in a world today that says, you know, I can get to heaven on my own accord. I can get to heaven on my own accord. Matter of fact, if you don't believe me, you just go to the funeral home and you sit around and listen. That loved one could be the evilest person that ever walked on God's green earth. But, oh, honey, he went to heaven. That tells me that you think you can get to heaven by something that you've done, not what God has done. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the only way to get to heaven, and you got to come through his grace and mercy, amen. It's got to be bestowed upon your heart by him, because it is a gift from him and not yourself. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourself, but it is the gift of God. It's the gift of God. So if I'm saved by grace through faith, then I want to know what faith is, don't you? And if you've been here, you probably heard me say this 1,000 times, and if you stay a little bit longer with me, you're going to hear 1,000 more. Because, I mean, we're saved by grace through faith. So what is faith? Faith, amen, is believing in something hidden so it becomes so. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. We have to hear the word to receive the gift of God's grace. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And that gift is extended to us by God through his grace and mercy toward us. We have to hear his word. I didn't know I was a sinner until I heard the word of God, who told me I was born in sin. And every mankind, amen, that's been born since Adam has been born in sin. Therefore, we must be born again. We must be born again by God's grace and mercy. By God's grace. What does God want to save us from? Our sin and from ourselves. He has to save me from myself a whole lot of time. Because if he didn't, I wouldn't be here today. I wouldn't be here today. In 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promises, some men count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. In Romans 10, 13 and 15 through 15, it says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How shall they call on him who they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent?" That's the problem we have today. We got a lot of preachers, but none of them been sent by God. Hello? "They have not been sent, as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things." And where does those good things originate from? God. God. God saves us by his marvelous grace, and that is something you will not find in the world. In the world. And what do you mean by the world? I mean in the sinful nature we're living in. You won't find in the world. His marvelous grace is something he wants to extend to you and your family and your neighbor and your country. Second thing I want you to see, that not only God's grace saves us, but God's grace is sufficient for us. It's sufficient for everything you and I will ever confront in this life. God's grace. Do you get weak sometimes? Do your faith fail you sometimes? Do you just want to throw in the towel and just walk away? Don't sit there, yeah, you have. What draws you back? God. He draws you back. His grace sustains you. Amen. His grace is sufficient for you. You realize that. Paul had a thorn in the flesh, the Bible tells us. In other words, he had some health issues that was confronting him. And here's a man of God, right? He keeps praying, but nothing happens. You ever kept praying and nothing happened? And the devil tell you, God has gone to sleep. He ain't listening to you. He don't want you. You ought to tell him he's a liar. God wants you. Paul prayed many times, but he gets a response from the Lord. And he said unto me, "My grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in your weakness." So you tell the devil to take a hike. You might be weak, but praise God, God is strong. Amen. He's holding my hand. And I can't even walk without him holding my hand. Oh, Paul realized that. Amen. When he heard these words, he said, "My grace is sufficient. I'm made stronger in you through your weakness." Amen. You're gonna preach. Amen. You're gonna tell others about me, and you are strengthened to do that. Amen. When you are weak. Because, see, when we are strong, we think we are doing all the things within our own power and might. It's in those weak moments we realize we can't do nothing without him. Hello? God's grace is there to save us. And the third thing I want you to see, God's grace helps us to resist the devil. Has the devil been bothering you this week? Oh, yeah. If he ain't bothering you, he's got you. He ain't worried about you. If he ain't bothering you, he got you. He's got you right where he wants you. But if he's bothering you, then you're on the right track. You're on the right track. God scorns the scorner and rejects those that trust in themselves and their own righteousness, but he rewards those humble. Remember what James said, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore he said, God resists the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Humble. Those that will bow before him and serve him faithfully. While the world says, I want to be the captain of my own ship. Those who humble before the Almighty God says, hey, I don't want to be the captain of my own ship or my own life. I want Jesus to be the captain and the pilot of my ship. Amen. I want him to be the captain and the pilot of my ship. Why do I want him to be the pilot and the captain of my ship? Because he's the master of the wind. You know, sometimes life gets bumpy, doesn't it? Sometimes it's like being in the open sea, amen, and those 30 or 40-foot waves of a fixing to overtake you. You know, the disciples were in that boat, weren't they? In the Sea of Galilee, and the waves began to overtake the boat, right? They was bailing water left and right. Could you see the 12 now? They were dipping that water, and maybe they had a hat. Maybe they used a shirt. I don't know what they used to dip that water out of the boat. They didn't have no bulge pumps. I mean, they were dipping and dipping and dipping, and the more they dipped, the more came in. You know what Jesus was doing? He was in the ship. He was sleeping. Sleeping in the midst of all of that activity. How could you sleep through something like that? Sometimes we ask the Lord, oh, are you sleeping? I mean, do you realize the roughness of life that I'm going through right now? I got tears running down my face. I can't even sleep. And the coffee don't do me no good. Hello? Do you realize what I'm going through, Lord? He just... No worry. No worry. Be happy. And that's what Christ is trying to tell us. When you think he's asleep in your boat, he's there with you. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. That's the word. You can count on the word. So when your boat gets a-rocking and the waves are overtaking it, hey, just remember Jesus is on board. And he's the master of the wind. They woke him up, didn't they? He heard their faintest cry. What's the problem? He says. I'm paraphrasing a little bit, you know. So, what's your problem? Don't you care we're about to die? Don't you know what's taking place? Oh, yeah, that's nothing. It may be nothing to you, but we're about to die. This boat is going down, and half of us can't swim. This boat is going down. No, it's not. Oh, heal a little faith. Oh, why are you so fearful? And all he did is said, peace, be still. And that was calmness. And the Bible says in some places, that immediately they was on the other side. They was on the other side. Why? Because Jesus was the captain of the vessel. He has no fear. But we have fear, don't we? Oh, fear overtakes us sometimes. Fear overtakes us from witnessing. Fear overtakes us, amen, from doing something in the house of God for God and his people. Fear, oh, I can't do that. Oh, I can't do that. How many times have you said, oh, I ain't going to do that. I can't do that. I ain't going to do that. I don't care how many times that bald-headed preacher ever get up there and tell me, that. I ain't going to do it because I can't. Well, you don't believe the word, do you? The word tells me in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I might not be able to do it within myself. On my own accord. Come on, stay with me here. But I can, amen, step out by faith. I can step out by believing in something. And so I had never done it before. I ain't never tried it before. But God, if you want me to do that, you'll step out by believing in Him and knowing that He's got your back. Amen. And that you can do it through Him. You can do it through Him who strengthens you. Amen. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. And you, when the devil comes knocking on your door, can resist the devil in Jesus' name. Because the Bible tells us right here in James 4:7, submit yourself. That's the problem. We don't want to surrender to God, do we? To do what He's called us to do. We don't want to surrender to God to resist the devil. But let me tell you, when you confront the devil on your own accord, you're going to lose. You're going to lose. But if you submit yourself, therefore, to God, and this is what you got to do first. You got to submit to God. He's the greater power. He's the greater power. Amen? The devil fears him. He don't fear you. But he fears God. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. He will flee from you. I like it when y'all help me preach. He will flee from you. And I want to say here, just remember that Satan doesn't have grace to give you. So don't expect anything of value from him. But Jesus has the words to eternal life. And He's the only one who has those words to eternal life. No one else. So who would you rather trust in? The one who can destroy you or one who can give you life and you can have it more abundantly? The choice is yours. But you have to resist the devil, don't you? By submitting to God. When we submit ourselves to God and learn to be content in Him, life can be so much simpler, so much more enjoyable. Oh, I love my life. And I've been living a long time for God. And I don't regret one bit of it. It hasn't always been a pleasant journey, but He's been with me every step of the way. There's some storms that I've been through. There's some storms our church has been through. But, hey, He's going to see us through. He's going to see us through. And if you're going through a storm today, let me tell you, submit to God, and He'll see you through. He'll see you through because, amen, He makes life much simpler and much more enjoyable, even in our weakness. Amen. Because I know when my eyes close down here, they're going to open over there. He's assured me that in His Word. Not some man, not some hearsay, but God Himself assured me that if I accept His grace and mercy and His gift of salvation, repent of my sin, my eyes will open in heaven. My eyes will open in heaven. Why? Because I believe Him, His Word. Amen? He is His Word. But somehow or another, you know, we may forget that from time to time. We may do that little thing called worry. Are you worried today? Are you struggling today? Just remember, all the striving, struggling, and worry doesn't really change anything. And you can be left feeling cheated, empty-handed when you allow those things to occupy your life totally. But God said, don't worry about that little stuff you got down here. Ain't nothing compared to what you're going to inherit over there. So don't worry. Don't struggle and don't strive over it. Just don't worry about it. because I'll supply all your needs according to my riches in glory. You're my child. So when life gets hard, amen, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Submit to God, knowing that he has your best interests at heart, even when life is unfair. Even when life is unfair. God took the first step toward you. God took the first step toward you and I when he sent Jesus to die for us. He took the next step when he saved your soul. Now he's waiting for you to take the next step to draw closer to him. For those who have been born again, he's waiting for you so he can relieve you of all your fear, all your struggles and all your worries, that you can enjoy life, not only here, but in eternity to come. And you know, this week I was praying, I said, thank you, Lord, for looking after me when I wasn't able to look after myself. Thank you for watching over me and keeping me safe. Soon to be 63 years. And you walked with me each step of the way. No wonder when life comes to a close, the old songwriter, I won't have to cross Jordan alone, because he's going to be there with me. Our Heavenly Father God, as we come to you today, Lord, we thank you for the words we've heard. Apply it to our hearts today, knowing that your grace, amen, is unmerited favor and love toward us. And if it's unmerited favor and love toward us, it's to everyone that we come into contact with, they as well. Lord, help us to be the light, God, to share your goodness and grace and mercy to others and share what you've done in our lives. Father, perhaps we don't know you as our Lord and Savior today. May we take that first step toward you, Lord, and accept that free gift of salvation today by repenting of our sins and confessing them before you, Lord, and ask for your mercy and your forgiveness. And Father, may we continue to work and serve you until you call us home and we wake anew in heaven, sheltered, safe within your arms. Bless your people today. Touch those who weren't here for various reasons, Lord.